Good evening, everyone. Dr. Les, are you with us? I can see you with us, Dr.
Yes.
Les. How are you, Dr. Les?
So, Shalom Rav, how are you?
When I hear your voice, always very good. Thank you, Dr. Les. How are you?
Yeah, Rav, Baruch Hashem, we're doing, we're still on edge. We don't know what's going to be happening, but people are pretty united. And I've been hearing more, even from non-from patients, non-from people, that they said we once had such faith in the Iron Dome. But we can't have faith in that anymore. We have to only have faith in Hashem. So I've been hearing this from a lot of people, a lot of.
That's how it should be.
Absolutely. So, Rav, I must just tell you, we're having amazing miracles. Earlier this week in Paris, in the Olympics. So I think it was in the judo section, or that the Israeli, he fought against, it was somebody from like. A Muslim country, and at the end of the competition, the Israeli won, and his opponent refused to shake his hand. But you know what happened? In the next round or the next game that he played, he fell on his shoulder and he fractured his arm. So he can't shake anyone's hand. So this person who refused to shake the Israeli, it's unbelievable. It's like mamish unbelievable. And but we remember, and they had an amazing ceremony at the Paris, in the Israeli embassy in Paris, to commemorate the remembrance of what happened in Munich in 72 with our Israeli athletes. And what was amazing is that the Olympic chief, Thomas Bach, he was there at the ceremony with other dignitaries and other ambassadors. And it's not a given because the Israeli delegation and the Israeli Olympic Association has had asked and begged and pleaded through the Olympic Games to have 1 minute silence just to remember, and they refused. Up until only a few years ago did the Olympic World Committee agree to participate in the remembrance for Jewish sportsmen that were massacred in Munich in 1972. So to have the Olympic chief attend, it's a big deal. But something which in Japan, they do not want us to attend. Tomorrow is going to be the commemoration in Nagasaki. That's where they had the bomb. And the Japanese mayor of Nagasaki decided he wants to exclude Israel, and he did. He didn't send an invitation. So what's amazing is that the United States and a lot of Western ambassadors have decided that they're not sending the ambassadors there. They'll send a very low delegation in protest that they're excluding Israel. So that's actually quite a very positive step, quite an amazing thing. Just very briefly, and I think you can get this at newsstands, Netanyahu gave an interview with Time magazine where he said for the first time, they said, "Are you sorry what happened?" And he said, of course he's sorry, but he's never come out and apologized to the Israeli public. And what's sad is he hasn't done an interview in Hebrew to the Israeli press. So people are saying it's just remarkable that he gives it to Time magazine and not to the Israeli press. But at least he did acknowledge that he is ex deeply sorry for what happened. It's taken so long to hear those words. Anyway, but Rav, I just want to mention, and this is very interesting, and I think we're going to end off here, where you really see what's happening in the world. When they had the hate marches in London on Shabbos, where they had hundreds of thousands of people marching with Intifada, marching with Hamas flags, marching with from the river to the sea. Even Ramaphosa said that Israel, Palestine will be free. There'll be no Israel. That was okay. The police stood by. They didn't allow any Jews to go nearby. They were entitled to their freedom of speech. But now, because the right wing in London, after the murder of these three innocent young children, and they say it was by asylum seeker, but they say it's false news, it's criminality. Who could have posted that false news? But the BBC often puts false reports about Israel, which inflames the world, especially with the Shifa Hospital, and they barely apologized after all reporting that it was an Israeli bomb when it was actually from the Palestinians themselves. But now you'll see on Sky TV and all the TV stations, they are clamping down on the so-called far right because they are protesting against all these migrants, or against a lot of, you know, the people that did it were, unfortunately, they were Muslim. So there's a lot of, like, hate, and there's a lot of anti-immigrant, anti-xenophobia, whatever it is, in England. But the police, when it comes to anti-Muslim, they're there on the streets. It's in the news. But when it came to those marches, which were called hate marches, Braverman, who was a secretary in the Conservative government, called it a hate march. She had to resign. But that's what it was. But today, because it's not against, you know, when it's against Yidden, it's fine. But when it's not, when it's against Muslims, it's not fine. So you see the double standards. It's just remarkable. It's absolutely remarkable. And I'd like you all and all our listeners, if there'll be any reaction, and this is something quite remarkable, because the show wasn't that long ago. There's a journalist, a very well-known journalist in Belgium. His name is Herman Brusselsmans. I haven't even seen it being reported in the news. But he came out and he said, and this was his statement, "I want to push a sharp knife in the throat of every Jew." And he's a very well-known journalist. He published this in a paper in Belgium. There's no outcry. There's no demonstrations. When it comes to Yidden, you know, it's such double standards. But you know what, Rav? We have to stand united. And in all the survivors that I speak to and I spoke to and I'll send it to you, a 92-year-old Rav who's a survivor from France, he said, and he gives a Daf Yomi Shir in Ramat Eshkol, amazing, Yisrael Azar. He said, you know, his message was, "I'm Yisrael Echad. If we're united, we will win. And we have to be united in our belief in Hashem and united as Am Echad. We Am Echad, we will be victorious."
בעזרת השם, שכוח דוקטור לייס for all the update. רבותיי, we're going to start the show. בעזרת השם, נעשה ונצליח, והשם עלינו ברחמיו ירוויה. Just before we start the show, I would like to welcome Taryn Levinstein. That's the first time that she joins us in the show. Taryn, welcome. Thank you for joining us. Also, I see Orna is back with us. Orna, thank you for joining us again. Okay. We would like to dedicate the shiur in the soul of Esther Kaden Bat Ketzia, Mordechai Ben Rahma, Rav Tamar Bat Zehava, Eitan Ben Keren Avishai Nae, Rav, tonight is the Yotzeit of Ari HaKadosh, Rabbi Yitzhak Luria Ashkenazi, Nishmato Tiyet Tzurah B'Tzur HaGaim, B'Tzur HaHaim, and please God, he will daven to HaKadosh Baruch Hu Ari HaKadosh, that Kadosh Baruch Hu will protect us, send us Mashiach Tzidkenu speedily. Also, Eitan Ben Keren Avishai Nae, Malka Regina Bat Joya, Yaakov Salomon Ben Farha, Yafa Bat Kalman, Farha Bat Talha, Nishmatam Tiyet Shgora B'Tzur HaHaim. Also, I would like to dedicate the shiur in the health of Liora Bat Miriam, Menashe Naji Ben Farha, Harav Moshe Ben Bahia Batya, Harav Moshe Ben Devorah, Harav Shlomo Yehuda, בן דליה ינוקה, רבי אברהם בן מרינה, דבורה בת אסתר, שיינה קיילה בת חנה, מרדכי דוד בן לאה, יהודה הלל בן שולמית לאה, חיים נחם בן פסח רזע הכהן, ברוך בן שרח ינה, יהודה בן אליעזר, מאיר בן יהודה, אריאל בן שילת, פסח יצחק בן אלה, איילה עדן בת רבקה, אורי בן יעל, חנניה שלום בן אביגדור, ומלכה בת רחל. Please God, refuah shlema to all of them, ולכל חולי עמו בית ישראל. Jeffrey, don't forget to unmute your microphone. We're going to start, רבותיי, this Shabbos, we're going to start Sefer Dvarim, the five books, the fifth books from the five books of Moses. We're going to read פרשת דברים, and בעזרת השם נעשה ונצליח. אלה הדברים אשר דיבר משה, אל כל ישראל בעבר הירדן, במדבר, בערבה, מול סוף, בין פרן ובין תופל ולבן, חצרות ודי זהב.
These are the words that Moses spoke to all Israel on the other side of the Jordan, concerning the wilderness, concerning the Arava, opposite the Sea of Reeds, between Paran and Tophel, and Lavan, and Chatzarot, and the Zahav.
Okay, here the Torah of Moshe Rabbeinu rebuke the children of Israel. What's happening here? Ele adevarim, the word ele. If we take the word ele, gematria, okay, 36. Aleph is 1, lamed is 30, hey is 5, together 36. What is it come to tell us? We have to understand what's the hidushia, the ele adevarim, number one. And then, if you look carefully, El Kol Bnei Israel. And then it says, Bamidbar, Ba'arava, he mentioned to them the places that the children of Israel walk in the journey. Bezrat Hashem will try to explain all of that in the first word, the first verse. But first, we have to start with Rashi HaKadosh. Rashi HaKadosh, Rabbi Shlomo Yitzhaki. He born in the city of Troyes in the north of France 984 years ago. Rashi HaKadosh says something extraordinary. He takes the first two words, Ele HaDevarim. What it means, Ele HaDevarim? Listen to what Rashi says, and we have to understand what Rashi said, because we explain that Rashi speak pshat. It sounds to us like pshat, but a matter of fact, it's not. He's speaking codes. Look what Rashi said. Lefi shehem divrei tochachot. Rashi said that, you know why Moshe mentioned the journeys? Why Dafka Moshe mentioned the journeys and not mention anything else? Moshe Rabbeinu mentioned only journeys. He doesn't tell him exactly what was the sin. Say the Rashi HaKadosh. Listen what he said, like this he said. Umana kan et kol ha-mekomot she-echrisu et ha-kadosh baruch hu. Ve-lachen, לא אמר אותם בפירוש, כדי לא לפגוע בכבודם של ישראל. And a pshat of the דברים, Rashi said that Moshe Rabbeinu mentioned to the children of Israel their journeys. But with journeys, from the 42 journeys, he mentioned only the place that make HaKadosh Baruch Hu cross with them. Why didn't mention this sin if he rebuked them? Say Rashi HaKadosh, not to hurt their feeling, to show them respect. That's pshat of the dvarim. What's hiding behind all of it? That's what we have to understand. Why did Rashi HaKadosh didn't tell the places? Because later on, and we're going to bring Be'ezrat Hashem, the Zera Shimshon, we see that he tell them the place. So why not to start with it? So we say that Rabbeinu Ephraim, we start with Rabbeinu Ephraim, he was a Rishon. He lived in the 12th century. Okay? His descendants from France. He said, take the word Ele. We say that it's Gematria 36. It's come to tell you, say, Rabbeinu Ephraim, that in every generation there is 36 tzaddikim. In every generation, there is 36 tzaddikim, as Hazal tell us in a Gemara in Masechet Sukkah, page 45, folio 2. It's come to tell you that those tzaddikim, they are the leaders. They're the leaders of the Jewish people. In that case, it's come to tell you, Ele HaDevarim, those the words that Moshe Rabbeinu spoke, and now we'll see how we're going to connect it to the tzaddikim, Be'ezrat Hashem, to those 33. Rabbi Chaim Ben Attar, he born in the city of Sali in Morocco. He born 328 years ago. And in his book, Or HaHaim HaKadosh, Rabbi Chaim Ben Attar say, it says from that that it says, El Kol Bnei Israel, to the, all the children of Israel, it's come to tell you something extra. It's come to tell you that Moshe Rabbeinu didn't spoke only to the children of Israel in the wilderness. It come to tell you in the Torah that in every generation, that it come to him to us the rebuke. And you have to remember that the Jewish people, when they didn't keep Torah or Mitzvot, they made HaKadosh Baruch Hu cross, HaKadosh Baruch Hu punished them. HaKadosh Baruch Hu punished them when they didn't follow the Torah and the Mitzvot. He said that you have to remember that those rebuke that are mentioned to you in the wilderness, it's applicable for the future generation. Come the Gaon Hida, Rabbi Chaim Yosef David Azulai. He born in Jerusalem around 300 years ago. By the way, he was a student of Rabbi Haim ben Attar that we mentioned earlier. And he actually bring in the Zohar HaKadosh in Tikkuni HaZohar in page 114, folio 1. He said something interesting. He said that Moshe Rabbeinu, a spark of the neshama of Moshe Rabbeinu been spread for the future generation. That means that the Talmidei Chachamim that we start with them, that we say that in every generation there is 36 tzaddikim, it's come to tell you, say, the Gaon Hida, that the spiritual energy of Moshe Rabbeinu, okay, become to help the tzaddikim, those 36 tzaddikim, to make sure that they're leading the Jewish people like they should. That means the same like Moshe Rabbeinu led the Jewish people for 40 years in the wilderness. We say that there is 36 tzaddikim in every generation. Okay? We say that Rabbi Haim ben Attar say that you have to remember he didn't speak only to the generation of the wilderness, those that walked for 40 years in a wilderness. No. Come Rabbi Haim Yosef David Azulay, the Hida, the Gaon Hida, and he said, let me explain to you all of it together. Let me put it all together. Said the Gaon Hida like this. What we're learning from here that you have to understand that in every generation there is 36 tzaddikim, that they get the energy, the spiritual energy from whom? From Moshe Rabbeinu. That spiritual energy to help them to lead the Jewish people in every situation. And that's the Hiddush. Ele ha-devarim asher diber Moshe el kol b'nei Yisrael. Rabotai, then he mentioned ba-midbar, ba-arava, he mentioned in a wilderness, in a valley. What is the Hiddush? What's happening here? I saw a beautiful commentary of Rabbi Mordechai Kohen. Rabbi Mordechai Kohen lived in the 16th century in Tzfat. He was the student of Maran HaBet Yosef, Rabbi Yosef Karo, the Maran HaBet Yosef that wrote the Shulchan Aruch. And he says something very interesting. He said that when a person, from here you learn something extraordinary. He came to teach us that when a person comes to teach others or come to rebuke others, okay, you have to understand that you have to speak to him in their own level. Why? He said. He said, look what Moshe Rabbeinu said to the children of Israel. He starts with the word Bamidbar, in the wilderness. The wilderness is us. He said, Rabbi Mordechai Kohen, that when Moshe Rabbeinu spoke to the multination, the Arab Rab, the multination, the riffraff, whatever you want to call them, how did he speak to him? Bamidbar. He spoke to him very harsh. But when it's come to speak to the children of Israel, how did he speak to him? He spoke to him softly. Ba'arava. Okay, in the valley. That is water. The valley, you can drink water. You have a lot of sources. The wilderness, there's no sources. If you didn't bring your food, you didn't bring enough water, the chances is that you're going to stay in the wilderness. He came to explain to you something very important. He said that you have to understand when you come to rebuke, when you come to talk to people, it depends who's the person that's standing in the front of you. It's come to tell you that you have to know how to speak to people. If people stubborn, then you have to speak to them in a different language. People soft, you speak to them softly. And David HaMelech say, Im Navar Tidbarer. David HaMelech say in the book of Tehillim, that if a person that loves to be cheeky, you have to be cheeky with him. Back. Im Navar Tidbarer. Ve'im Ikesh Titakash. When a person is stubborn, you have to go with him head collision. Why? Because he doesn't understand any other language. And that's what it says. Bamidbar, Ba'arava, Molsuf. Wherever you make them angry, you make a Kadosh Baruch Hu angry, he spoke to them in a different language. And that's the Hiddush. Every week, we bring the Hiddush of the Zera Shimshon. Rabbi Shimshon Haim Nachmani, he born in a city of Modena in the north of Italy 318 years ago. And he says something very interesting. And he say, I don't understand, Moshe Rabbeinu, you start by telling the children of Israel where they make you cross. How do you say that? By hinting to them. You don't tell them directly. But later on, in verse 22, for example, you tell them exactly. You remind them the golden calf, the sin, where they sin with the golden calf. Later on in Parashat Ekev, few parashiot, okay, in verse chapter 9, verse 16, you actually mention to them Mahloket Korah. You actually mention to them that the problem that you have with Korah and his followers, and how HaKadosh Baruch Hu got cross with them, and the punishment that HaKadosh Baruch Hu punished them. In Parashat Ekev, chapter 11, verse 6, you actually mention to them, okay, directly. What did you mention to them? Sorry, you mentioned to them the Chet Egel. And in verse 22, you mentioned the sin of the Meraglim. So wait a minute. Rashi, you telling me that Moshe Rabbeinu hint to them when he mentioned the places. I understand. But what later on, Moshe Rabbeinu spoke to them directly and mentioned to them the sin, exactly where they done and what they done wrong. What is the Hiddush here? Say the Rabbi Shimshon Haim Nachman, Ezra Shimshon. He explained like this. According to the pshat of the Dvarim, because the Zera Shimshon speak more mystically, we explain, more Kabbalistically. He explained like this. He said that at the beginning, he hinted to them. Why? Because he was worried not to offend them. He make sure that he going to honor them. He didn't want to hurt them. But he said later on, he told them directly. Why? Because it's come to teach you something. Those that sin too much, he hint to them. You know, you done a small avera. Those that sin heavily, he mentioned to them exactly where they was wrong and what they was wrong. Now, he didn't hint to them anymore. He told them. That's the pshat of that volume. But he said, let me tell you a deeper explanation. Hazal tell us in the Gemara in Masechet Sanhedrin on page 13, folio 2. There is a concept in a Jewish religion that one Jewish responsible for another Jewish. What does it mean? It's like a chain. We have a chain, and every Jew is one ring on a chain. If you break one ring from the chain is broken. He said that you have to understand that the Jewish people, when did they become obligated, responsible for one and other mistake? He said only after they crossed the Jordan Valley, when they entered the land of Eretz Israel. Before they entered the land of Eretz Israel, they didn't have that concept that if someone sinned, I'm responsible for him. I'm part of that chain. You see, let me explain to you. Moshe Rabbeinu spoke harshly to who? To those that sin, do we say? He said, but here Moshe Rabbeinu tell them, Be'ever HaYarden, where did Moshe Rabbeinu originally spoke to them? Before they entered the land of Eretz Israel, by the Jordan Valley. He had spoke to him very gently. Why? Because they didn't have that concept of one responsible for another, the change. One ring have to be close with the others. He said like this. When did the Jewish people got that responsibility after they entered the land of Eretz Israel? After they entered the land of Eretz Israel, when they're already in the land of Eretz Israel. Moshe Rabbeinu spoke to them harshly. Why? It's to tell you something very important. Those that make the little sin have to understand where they was wrong And he spoke to them very harshly. And he spoke to them directly and he explained to them where they was. Those that make the small sin, he mentioned them where, he hinted to them before they entered the land of Eretz Israel. But later on, when they got to the land of Eretz Israel, he also rebuked who? Those that done the big averot about Heta Meraglim. That's why we're going to fast on Tuesday. If the Mashiach wouldn't come, Be'ezrat Hashem will come, and then we don't have to fast. That, what is it? From Tisha B'Av. That caused what? The destruction of the temple. Then we have, we say, Het Ha'egel. What does it mean, Het Ha'egel? The sin, Lo'aleinu, of the golden calf. Then he spoke to them also harshly. Where? With Korach and his followers. That caused a lot of dispute among the Jewish people. Instead of being united, they broke the unity. That's when he spoke to them harshly, after they entered the land of Eretz Israel, because then they got that concept of one responsible for the others. And that's when he started to speak to them. That's how the Zera Shimshon explained that. Let's go to verse 2. And in verse 2, it says something very interesting. He mentioned, how many days of walking? Look what it says. 11 yom mihorev derech har Seir ad Kadesh Barnea.
11 days from Horev by way of Mount Seir to Kadesh Barnea.
Okay, here Moshe Rabbeinu tell the Jewish people that the journey from the Mount Horev to the place that we call Kadesh Barnea took them 11 days. 11 days? Let's see. We have to understand two questions. Why Moshe Rabbeinu tell the children of Israel that they traveled for 11 days? What, they didn't know? They walked with him. So what's the hidush that Moshe Rabbeinu have to tell them? Listen, you walked in a wilderness from a place that's called Horeb, where you receive the Torah on Mount Sinai, that's Horeb, Har Horeb, to Kadesh Barnea, 11 days. But they don't know. What's the Hiddush here? So I'm going to bring Rabotai today. I'm going to do the Pardes step by steps. Pshat, Remesh, Drash, Sod. According to the Pshat, the simple understanding. Then Remesh, the hint. Then we'll do Be'ezrat Hashem also Drash and Sod. Let's start with the Pshat. It's not really the Pshat, it's more Pshat and Drash together. Okay? And a bit, but it's more Pshat. Say Rabbi Ovadia Misforno. Rabbi Ovadia Misforno, born in a city of Cesena in the north of Italy. He born 554 years ago. He was also a doctor, like the Rambam, the Ramban. Okay, in his profession, he was a doctor, besides being a great scholar and wrote commentary on the Torah, like the Ramban and the Rambam, and Rashi HaKadosh, and Or HaChaim HaKadosh, and many others that wrote commentary on the Torah. He said like this, he said that the main reason that the children of Israel have to walk for 40 years in a wilderness, it was because we explained the sin of the Meraglim, the sin of the spy that they spoke Lashon Hara. And he said like this, every time that they used to, between journey to journey, Moshe Rabbeinu used to rebuke them and he used to say to them, remember that the journey that's supposed to take 11 days, that was from Mount Horeb to Kadesh Barnea, took you 3 days. Didn't took you 11 days. You know why? Because in that journey, you was all united. And that journey, you was all righteous. And you got the help of the Almighty. Se'ata Dishmaya. Se'ata Dishmaya, the help of the Almighty. He said that it's come, Moshe Rabbeinu come to teach us a message. The Torah, the word Torah is a menu. He came to teach us the message that you have to understand that when you follow the orders, the law, keeping mitzvot, whatever Kadosh Baruch Hu command you, you're going to help the help of heaven. At the moment that you don't follow what HaKadosh Baruch Hu told you, that help from HaKadosh Baruch Hu leave you alone. Now, you didn't want me. You want to battle by yourself. Go battle by yourself. Grow back your head. You want to break your own head? Bechavo, do it. Say, Rabbi Ovadia Misforum. What Moshe Rabbeinu tell us in those words, Ehad Asar Yom Mechorev Ad Kadesh Barnea, that if you want to have the help of HaKadosh Baruch Hu, follow the menu. What is the menu? The Torah. Keep mitzvot. Keep the Torah. That's all I'm asking. I don't ask you for more. Just do what you're obligated to do as a Jew. And then you get the help of HaKadosh Baruch Hu. But at the moment that you don't want to do that, then you're by yourself. Then you have to break your head. By yourself, you have to battle. And then you have chorus. That's Rabbi Ovadia Misforno, according to the chat and a bit of a drash. Okay. According to the remez, we say that 11 days, what is that 11 days that they're talking about, that journeys? He said that now I'm going to connect it, Rabotai, to Tisha Be'av and the three fasts that we have, that they are Tisha B'Av, the 17 of Tammuz, and Asara B'Tevet, the 10 of Tevet. How's it work? The Mefarshim explained like this. He said you have 9 days from the beginning of Rosh Chodesh Av until Tisha B'Av, those nine. He said you have the fast of 11 B'Tammuz, that's number 10. He said you have the fast of Asara B'Tevet, the 10 of Tevet, that's 11. He says the Torah come to him, to you, that when we're reading Parashat Dvarim, it awards those 11 difficult days that we have a year. Yemet Tzar, a day of agony and pain. About what? About the destruction. To him, to you, what caused the destruction? Number 11, it awards those 9 days that you're suffering a year, every year. That's what's number 11. That's the remez. Let's do the sod. The sod is more on a Kabbalistic level, more the mystical part of it. The Zohar HaKadosh on our parsha, explain like this. The Zohar HaKadosh say, what does it mean 11 days? He say that there is in the world 11 evil forces, negative forces in the world. That means 11 evil forces. Remember that. And we'll explain that. He said like this. He say that if you look carefully, when you read the parsha of the spices, the korban of the spices. How many spices there is on that korban, on that sacrifice? 11. Why dafka 11? He said that when you're reading the parashat Petoma Ketoret, the korban of the Ketoret, it's to weaken and to annihilate those 11 forces that there is in the world. By that you have to walk in a wilderness, that you mentioned those 11 days, is to weaken, to try to get rid of those evil forces that there is in the world, those negative forces that there is. Okay? If you look carefully, when Moshe Rabbeinu been told about the Mishkan, to do the Mishkan, HaKadosh Baruch Hu tell him that you should do 11 yereot, 11 curtain, 11 pieces of curtain. What is those curtain made from? From the skin of the goat. Why dafka 11? Said the Mekubalim that's to try to make sure that in a mirror that you walking in a wilderness, that that's the capital. We explained that the wilderness, Bamidbar, it's the capital of all the evil forces. It said to weaken and to try to annihilate those 11 forces that there is in the world. Evil forces. Another explanation, Rabotai, and now I'm going to link it to what? To Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur. Rabotai, the Ari HaKadosh, Rabbi Yitzhak Luria Ashkenazi, that tonight, that he's your child. 490 years ago he born, he explained like this. He said that between Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, Aseret Yemei Tshuva, the 10 days of repentance, we add up in Tfilat HaAmida 11 words. What a day. Say like this, Zochrenu Lechaim, Melech Hafetz B'chaim. How much is that? 5. What did we add up more? He said like this, Kedvenu Besefer Chaim Lema'anach Elokim Chaim. 6. He said together 11. Said the Ari HaKadosh, you mustn't add up and you mustn't subtract. Why not to add up and why not to subtract? Say Ari HaKadosh that those 11 words that Hazal constitute for us in Tfilat Amida, when we daven Amida, it's to cancel those 11 forces that try to criticize against us between Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur. Remember that on Aseret Yemei Tshuva. And so that's the Hiddush. Now we can understand why Moshe Rabbeinu telling the children of Israel 11 days. What is those 11 days? Now we understand on a pshat of the Dvarim. We have the Remez. We have the Drash that we brought from Rabbi Ovadia Misforno. And then we brought also the Zohar HaKadosh and Rabbeinu Yitzhak Luria Ashkenazi Ari HaKadosh to come to tell you that by that, that you mentioned, number one, in the spices, 11 spices every day when you read the Parashat HaKetoret, you're actually annihilating those 11 forces from you. Because people do have a vote. And those evil forces, that's the angel that tried to go and say to HaKadosh Baruch Hu and criticize against us, look what Chaim Yankel done, what Chaim Shmerel done. By that, that you mentioned the 11 spices in the Ketoret 3 times a day, you try to get rid of them in the morning, in a mincha and ma'ariv. You get rid of them. And that's why we're saying it 3 times. Let's go to verse 5. Look what it says here. Be'ever ha-yarden, okay? Where is it? Be'ever ha-yarden, be'eretz Moab, ho'il Moshe, באר את התורה הזאת לאמור, בכבוד.
On the other side of the Jordan, in the land of Moab, Moses began explaining this Torah, saying.
Okay. Explaining the Torah, saying. Rashi HaKadosh tell us, באר את התורה, he explained the Torah, he explained it in 70 languages. 70 languages. Moshe Rabbeinu, the Torah. Why do you have to explain the Torah in 70 languages? What's the Hiddush here? Why did Moshe Rabbeinu have to explain the Torah in 70 languages? That's the Shiloh of the Mefarshim. Okay, Rabotai, Be'ezrat Hashem, I'm going to try to connect it to what's happening today in the world. Be'ezrat Hashem, that HaKadosh Baruch Hu will give me the wisdom, and look how it's fitting. The Mefarshim say like this. The Mefarshim say, Moshe Rabbeinu knew that the children of Israel inevitably going to enter the land of Eretz Israel. They have to enter the land of Eretz Israel. They have to conquer the land. Okay, they have to fight. Who's going to do the fighting? Yoshua Binun. He's going to fight. Okay? He fight with the seven nation that was in Israel, in the land of Eretz Israel. Said the Mefarshim, Moshe Rabbeinu knew that in the future will be a group that called United Nation. Will be a group that the Kotun Hag, that they're going to say, Jewish people, who given you the rights to conquer the land, to build new settlements, to be in Eretz Israel? What are you doing there? Say the Mefarshim, Moshe Rabbeinu saw it all in his Holy Spirit. So he translated the Torah in 70 languages, that when you go to the hard court, when you go to the United Nation, you show them the Holy Torah. Here's the Holy Torah that we have. That we got from who? From the Almighty, the Creator. He created the world. He told us in the Torah that he given us the land. And you'll have to fight to conquer the land. But the difference is that the people that sit in the government, in a nice word, I say, they forgot what it says in the book. I don't want to say that they don't believe in the book. They forgot. But if we're going to go with this book, they're not going to talk. David Ben-Gurion, in 1948, Hey Iyar, they ask him in a United Nation, on what right you won the land of Eretz Israel? He took the Tanakh, he took the Bible, and he said to him, here. That's our title deeds for the land of Eretz Israel. And they all kept quiet. Haval that today, they don't do it. 76 years later, they forgot. That's our problem. Okay, that's according to the Pshat, Remez, a little bit of political. But there's another idea. You say, the Rabbi Mordechai Cohen, in his book, Sifte Cohen, he say, if you take the word ho'il, okay, we see there it say, Be'ever Hayarden, Be'eretz Moav, Ho'il Moshe, Be'eretz HaTorah, Ho'il. What it mean, Ho'il? Ho'il, it mean, if you change the sequence of the letters, you get the word Eliyahu. It's come to tell you that for the future, when the Mashiach comes, Eliyahu HaNavi, okay, he's going to translate the Torah. He's going to be the one, okay, to translate the Holy Torah, the same like Moshe translated. That means that Eliyahu HaNavi going to tell the nation where we have the rights for the land of Eretz Israel. That's the Hiddush. Okay, let's go to verse 8. In verse 8, it's look what it says. Re'e natati lifnechem et ha'aretz. Bo'u urshu et ha'aretz. Asher nishba Adonai la'avotechem. Le'avraham, li'itzhak u'li'akob. Latet lahem u'lezar'am ahareihem. Bechavod.
See, I have given the land before you. Come and possess the land that Hashem swore to your forefathers, to Abraham, to Yitzhak, and to Yaakov, to give them and their children after them.
Oh, very clear. Okay. Very, very clear. Nachon, Jeffrey? Okay. But now you see more clear. It's Rabbi Chaim ben Attar say about this verse. Look how the verse starts. Re'eh, singly. Look, singly. Natati lifnechem, in front of all of you. He moved from singly to plural. What is the Hiddush? Say, Rabbi Chaim ben Atar, I don't understand. You start with singly and immediately you move to plural. Why? Why you start with singly and you move to plural? Why didn't start with plural and continue all of it with plural? Because most of the verse is in plural. You can say re'u, no. There's a big difference, sorry, between re'e, that it's in singly in Hebrew, to re'u. Re'u, it's plural to everyone. Why did they say the Rabbi Chaim ben Atar, why did he start in singly and he moved to plural? He can start all of it. Say Rabbi Chaim ben Atar, extraordinary answer. He said, when it's come to look at the land of Eretz Israel, everyone see the same land. You go to the Kotel, you see the Kotel. You want to see the Kotel, you see the Kotel. Okay. You want to go to Ma'arat HaMachpelah, the grave of the patriot, you see the grave of the patriot. You want to see Jerusalem, you see Jerusalem. You want to see the south of Eretz Israel, you see the south of Israel. And etc. He says something extraordinary. He said that when it's come to look, each one looks the same, see the same. He said that they have another thing. When it's come to get impression, everyone have a different impression. It says when you go to the Kotel, and Chaim Yanko go to the Kotel, or Chaim Shmero go to the Kotel, they get a different impression from the Kotel. He said, Re'e, natati lifnechem et ha'aretz, bo'u urshu et ha'aretz, come and inherit the land. But you have to understand, what's your impression from the land? Am I coming to look at the land, how beautiful only the land? Or I'm coming to see the high-tech of the land? I'm coming to see the spiritually of the land. What am I looking? Each one of us can look at different. He said, when you come to the Eretz Israel, everyone see the same. But each one of us have a different impression. Am I get impressed how much Talmudet Torah there is in Eretz Israel? How much Yeshivot there is in Eretz Israel? How much Torah growing in Eretz Israel? Oh, I'm impressed about the highest tower in Tel Aviv. Or I'm impressed the promenade by the beach in Tel Aviv. He said, that's the difference. He said, when you come to the land of Eretz Israel, if you want to come, bo urshu et ha'aretz, that means that each one of you have to look at the positive impression of Eretz Israel. Look at the good thing of Eretz Israel. That's the Hiddush. What does it mean to us? It's come to tell us that when you come, for example, let me give a different analogy. People going to Shiur Torah, going to listen to Shiur Torah. Each one heard the same what the rabbi said. There is how many people in a room? They all heard the same. But each one got a different impression from the show. Okay? These people come, listen, they stay apathetic. But there is some that listen to what the rabbi say and got the impression. Got different impression, different. They become so impressed. They took the words and they move on. There's those. Okay, the rabbi said, no. And they continue with the line, apathetic. It's come to tell you that you have to understand that when you come to the land of Eretz Israel, all of you are going to see the same land. All of you are going to see the same view. But what's your impression from Eretz Israel? That's what we have to ask ourselves. Let's go to verse 12. Wow, the time is running. I need to try to keep into that. Here we see that Moshe Rabbeinu complaining to the children of Israel. And I'm going to try to explain what was the complaint of Moshe Rabbeinu. How? We're going to learn that with the Rambam, the Ramban. Okay, not Rambam, Ramban. We'll explain it. Echa esa levadi, tirhatchem, umasa'achem, verivchem.
How can I alone carry your contentiousness, your burdens, and your quarrels?
Okay. Here Moshe Rabbeinu said to the Jewish people, how can I carry? Come the Rambam, Ramban. The Ramban, born in a city of Catalonia in Spain. He born 830 years ago. In his commentary on the Torah, I mentioned that he's in profession, he was a doctor also. In his commentary on the Torah, he explained the three different ideas. What does it say? Tirhatchem. The first one, how do you call it in English? Tirha? Jeffrey, the first one?
Sorry. We say contentiousness. You're what up against each other.
Yeah, what is it? Then that Moshe Rabbeinu here have to have a lot of hassle. Why? To teach them the holy Torah and the mitzvot. Where do we learn that? We learn that from Sefer Yitro, in Parashat Yitro. In Parashat Yitro, in chapter 18, verse 16, what did he say? Ve'odati et chokei Elohim ve'et torotav. I needed to spread the words of the Almighty and His law and His Torah. So the first thing is speaking about that Moshe Rabbeinu, the first thing that he have to do with us, with the children of Israel, to teach us Torah. The second one, umasa'achem, and your burden. What burden? That Moshe Rabbeinu, each time that the Jewish people done something wrong, and HaKadosh Baruch Hu punished the Jewish people, Moshe Rabbeinu have to dive into HaKadosh Baruch Hu on every problem that the Jewish people had. They didn't have water in a wilderness. Kadosh Baruch Hu, please bring water. The children of Israel complain about the manna. Kadosh Baruch Hu, please bring the meat. They complain in a sea of weeds. Kadosh Baruch Hu, please split the sea. And etc. and etc. and etc. Every time I needed to daven for you, for every little chorus that you cause, like a father and a child. What was the third one? And Rifchem. Rifchem is your faribble. Here Moshe Rabbeinu said that even to your own faribble, I needed to make peace. How? By that my third mission was that I needed to sit and to do a judgment, a din Torah. I needed to become a judge because one said this, one said that. This one took for me. This one didn't pay me. I needed to do din Torah for 40 years in the wilderness between you two. Where do we learn that? V'shafateti ben ish u'ben re'ehu. That's what we learn in Parashat Yitro again. It's come to teach us that Moshe Rabbeinu in the wilderness have three important missions. What was their mission? It's number one, to teach us Torah. Number one, to teach us the Torah, to teach us the mitzvot. The second mission that Moshe Rabbeinu had is that every time that we cause chorus, you came to me, that I can dive into HaKadosh Baruch Hu. It's in Parashat Yitro, Ki yavou elai ha'am lidrosh et ha'elokim. Every time that you caused problem, that you caused chorus, or you needed something, you came to me to dive into HaKadosh Baruch Hu, that HaKadosh Baruch Hu will bring it, or will change the decree, and etc. The third mission, When you have a rebel between yourselves, I needed to make peace between a man and a fellow friend. He said, Doge, what it means in that verse, said the Ramban, that Moshe Rabbeinu have three mission, main mission, for the 40 years in the wilderness. That's the Hiddush. Let's go to chapter 2. With that, we're going to end up, Be'ezrat Hashem, I want to end up with something good. Chapter 2, verse 7. Because it's always good to end up with something good. And look what it says. Ki Adonai Elohecha berachacha bechol ma'ase yadecha. Yada lechdecha et hamidbar hagadol hazeh 40 shana. Adonai Elohecha imcha lo hasarta davar.
For Hashem your God has blessed you in all your handiwork. He knew your way in this great wilderness. This 40-year period, Hashem your God was with you. You did not lack a thing.
What it means, for 40 years you was in the wilderness and you never lacked him. Anything. Rabotai, Be'ezrat Hashem, I'm going to bring now two different interpretations, two ways to look at that verse. Hazal, in a Midrash Shoher Tov, there is a Midrash that called Shoher Tov, it's on the book of Tehillim. And in the book of Tehillim, in chapter 23, if you look there, he explains something extraordinary. He explained that verse. And he said, like this, he gave an analogy. He said, that if we have a visitor for the first time coming to visit us, oh, we open the door for him, we give him a great meal, we respect him like you can't believe. By the first day, by the second day, a little bit less, but we still, by the fourth day, a little bit less, and etc. and etc. He said, after a month or two or a year, we get used to him. We don't do the same respect like the first time that he came to visit us. He said, but when the children of Israel was in the wilderness, whatever they got on the first day, they also got on the last day that they was in the wilderness. That means that they never been got something less that they got on the first day. That the children of Israel, for 40 years that they was in a wilderness, all of those 40 years was equal. What they received in the first day, that's what they received on the last day of the 40 years. And that's what it says, 40 shana, 40 years that you walk in a wilderness, you lacked nothing. What you wanted on the first day, you got. Not only that, you even got more. You got the manna, but you lacked meat. Even that, HaKadosh Baruch Hu later on bring you. Even more. That's the Hiddush. That they lack nothing all of those 40 years. Okay? That's the Midrash. But the Chachamim explained to them, Velo hasar tadavar, Mazi, you didn't miss nothing. What it mean? A thing. Davar. Maze davar? Milshon dibur. Davar is dibur, is talk. Listen to that Hiddush, what Hachamim tell us. Velo hasarta davar come to tell you when you was in a wilderness and you wish to have something. Even that, you didn't have to say, and HaKadosh Baruch Hu brought it to you. Where the example? Say Hachamim like that. When a person got the manna, if he wanted to test in a manna that he eating chicken shawarma, in mine, you have to think about it, and he tested chicken shawarma. If he decide that he want to have beef shawarma, the test was beef shawarma. If you wanted to have a lamb, it was a lamb. That's the Hiddush. You don't have to ask. You just have to think and HaKadosh Baruch Hu fulfill your wishes. Bnei Israel was in the wilderness for 40 years. Did they have a tailor for their clothes? No, they've grown up with the clothes. You was a baby, you've grown up, the clothes grow with you. Do they have a shoemaker? No. Because HaKadosh Baruch Hu makes sure that the shoes that you have grown up with you. Not only that it's grow up, nothing happened to the shoes. They've never been teared. That's the Hiddush. You wanted water. You have Be'era Shel Miriam, the well of Miriam. That's where you got all your wisdom. That's where you got all your chokhmah. He say you lacked of nothing. You just have to think about it and HaKadosh Baruch Hu fulfill your wishes. Be'ezrat Hashem, that HaKadosh Baruch Hu will fulfill all the Jewish people's wishes, that he send us number one Mashiach Tzidkenu. We want Mashiach now, 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 now. Number two, bring us peace on the land, protect the children of Israel in Eretz Israel, protect us in the diaspora, protect our soldier, the member of the security, and we bring peace to the world, not only to Eretz Israel, peace to the world. And that's what we ask him. So Be'ezrat Hashem, that HaKadosh Baruch Hu gonna listen to our wishes, to every Jew, and will send us Mashpiach Tzidkenu speedily in our day. Amen. Ken Yehir Ratzon. Rabotai, I hope that you enjoyed the show. If there is any question, please stay in the line. There is very interesting question that people ask. It's sometimes people leave and missing beautiful question that people ask. There's a very interesting question sometime, and I have to admit, sometimes it's a challenging to answer. Before I forget, on Shabbos, an hour before Mincha, I give a show at Yeshiva College on the same subject, but in different concept, in more depth what we learned today. So, Rabotai, first of all, I would like to thank each one of you individually. Thank you very much for joining us tonight for the show. Number two, to wish each one of you, before I forget, Shabbat Shalom, that you'll have a peaceful Shabbos, Be'ezrat Hashem, to you, to your family, to our brothers and sisters, to our kids in Eretz Israel and all over the world. Those of you that have questions, Bechavod, please ask. Unmute the microphone and you can ask questions. Bechavod.
Hello, it's Anthony. How are you?
Erev Tov, Antonio. How are you?
All right, thanks. First of all, how often did the manna come down? Was it three times a day for every meal that the manna came down from heaven?
No, one in the morning, early morning. And then they have to go and collect it.
And did they have the manna last them the whole day?
The manna, what was the manna? What was the manna? Manna, what is manna? So the Torah tells us, Kezera Agad. What is God? It's small, like a seed. The seed, small seed. Omer la gulgolet. Seed. You eat it, and you was full all day. And you can imagine whatever food you wanted. You shocked, huh, Anthony? That means that seed, you eat a little bit, you don't have to finish it. And he will say, and it fulfills you. Now I'm going to tell you a Hiddush. That all the children of Israel, when there was in a wilderness, listen to that, for 40 years, that there was in a wilderness, they never gone to relieve themselves for big. Only because they drink water, they have to go and release themselves from water. But big, none of them needed to go to the toilet to relieve themselves. Why? Because the manna, Hazal call it lehem ha'evarim. It used to penetrate into the vein And you didn't need to relieve them yourself. Today, when we're eating food, some of it penetrates to the vein, mix with the blood. Most of it, we have to relieve ourselves. Why? Because yes, it's not healthy. When the manna was 100% healthy, it's mixed with the blood and people wasn't sick. For 40 years, they was in the wilderness. I don't think that they have a doctor. They didn't have Zaka. They didn't have Achala. They didn't need it. Not only that, they didn't have hospital. The food that they eaten was 100% healthy.
Yeah. Unbelievable.
You understand the Hiddush now?
Yes. And what bracha did they make on the manna?
Oh, very good question. That's the question of the Rashba. Rashba? I think that it's the Rashba, Rabbi Shlomo ben Aderet. He asked, what blessing you say on the manna? He said, Baruch ata Hashem, Elokeinu melech ha'olam, hamotzi lechem min ha'shamayim. Min ha'shamayim, lo min ha'aretz, min ha'shamayim. That means that the food came from heaven. Today, what we say, amotzi lechem min ha'aretz. What it mean, ha'aretz? From the ground.
From the ground.
No. Say the Rashba. Rashba. I think it's the Rashba, if I'm not mistaken. Rashba. I think it's the Rashba. Motzi lechem min ha'shamayim. Beseder?
Okay, very interesting.
Thank you very much. Thanks for asking. Anyone else? Who else want to ask? Please unmute the microphone. Bechavod.
Yes, Rob, I'd like to
Jeffrey, how about COVID?
Thank you.
How are you, Jeffrey? Thanks for reading for us.
Thank you. Rob, this is for us in our day. Probably the most powerful sentence when we just read it. Ki Hashem Elohecha. That Hashem has blessed us in all our work. And then it carries on. He knew our way in this great wilderness. Look what we did. Look at the rebellions. Look at the Avodah Zarah. Look at the fighting and what have you. With all that, he blessed us in everything because we are his people. So it must give us strength. It must give us strength. So things aren't so great between ourselves. Yes, the unity must be there, but even if it's not, and we're fighting it, and we're still bowing down to Avodah Zarah in one way or another, with all that, he still blessed us, and he still brought us this. So this is such a chizuk for us that we are now in this period that he is blessed us, and he blessed us for 40 years, and he will do it again. And he would do it all that. Otherwise, we wouldn't have even gone into the land. We should never have gone into the land if he didn't bless us, if he didn't look after us. So with all our machloikas, with all everything that we're going through, he's blessed us. So we must take strength from that. We must pull together.
You want me to connect it to today? I'll connect it for what we're living today.
Yes.
2 weeks ago and 3 weeks ago, we've been told that Israel managed to put the hand on Mohammed Def. Mohammed Def have 12 life. 12 life, like a cat. You can't kill him. When did they kill him? Tammuz. Where did they kill Ahinya? Ismail Ahinya? Ab. Where did they kill the chief of staff of the Hezbollah? We see the love of the Kadosh Baruch Hu. The prophet Yirmiyah said, okay? Yirmiyah, that HaKadosh Baruch Hu will turn all of those four fasts that they are Tisha B'Av, 17 of Tammuz, Asara B'Tevet, V'Tzom Gedaliah, Le'amim Tovim U'Lesason. We already see the love of HaKadosh Baruch Hu. During those time that the Maran Shulchan Aruch wrote, Mishenichnas Av Mema'atim Besimcha, when the month on Av come on us, bring the Simcha down. And we know we're not allowed to listen to music. We're not allowed to eat meat until Tisha B'Av for those 9 days. Or for the 3 weeks from Yudzayim B'Tammuz, we're not allowed to listen to music until Tisha B'Av. Rabotai, look at the light that HaKadosh Baruch Hu opened for us. When we're going to get rid of Yahya Sinwar, I hope it's very soon. But HaKadosh Baruch Hu prepared for us a big surprise. He loved us. He never left us. He punished him, everyone. Rabotai, the Houthis, remember, they sent an unoccupied airplane to Eretz Israel. Remember that blow and killed one guy. Israel attacked them. That was Israel. How did HaKadosh Baruch Hu punish them now? Blood all over. People dying left hand and right in Yemen by the Houthis. Where? In Hodeidah. In a south, in a west south of Yemen. Rabotai, something to open our eyes. Iran. We killed Ismail Haniyeh. Ismail Haniyeh been killed in his own, where? In his own hotel. Iran threatening the Jewish people. Kadosh Baruch Hu sent them a message. Cloud of dust. How many people died there? How many people have to be hospitalized there? Kadosh Baruch Hu warning them. Look how much HaKadosh Baruch Hu loves us. HaKadosh Baruch Hu never left any Jews. And he said, Imo Anochi Betzara. I'm with him. Every Jew. In every chorus that a Jewish person have, I'm with him. A Jewish person that's sitting behind bars in a jail, HaKadosh Baruch Hu with him. What does it mean? That the present, the divine of HaKadosh Baruch Hu gone with him. HaKadosh Baruch Hu doesn't leave any Jew. Sometimes, you know, we like kids, we naughty. So we need the patch and the tochus. We need a good clap to wake us up. And sometimes the kids doesn't get wake up. So HaKadosh Baruch Hu giving us, send us another message, a bit more to waken us up. He said, that's it. That's the Hiddush here. HaKadosh Baruch Hu never leave us. Bechol ma'aseh yedechem. In every situation. I'll be with you. Even when HaKadosh Baruch Hu given chorus to a person, he's doing it ma'albi, not harshly. That's the Hiddush. You follow, Jeffrey?
Yeah.
I hope I've given you the right answer.
You started off with that. You started with it was the harsh of the desert and the Arava, the softness. And this is what you're ending on.
Yeah, Baruch Hashem. But you understand? Yeah. Look how HaKadosh Baruch Hu warning the Houthis. Don't do it again. If you're planning to attack, remember that's my nation. I'm just sending you a red warning, the flood. Sending to Iran. before you're going to attack Israel, yeah, I'm sending you a dust storm. Be careful what's going to come. Be careful. You understand? You remember,
we should only see it, like you've explained. People should only see it, the miracle, all the time.
It's open. It's open eyes. Look. Yeah. Look what it's doing to us.
Each one, look
at the 7th of October. All of those that celebrate and used to give baklavot, you know, that's the famous dish, the sweet dish that they give it when they killed, and all those that was talking to their parents, look, I killed my handful of blood. Where are they today? The parents crying because the Israeli Defense Force killed them. Each one of them going to be killed. Why? Because HaKadosh Baruch Hu wants revenge. So he allowed us to kill them. This world is not a coincidence. I explained that on Sunday in the show. There's no coincidence in a Jewish language. In a Jewish language, it's called Bemikre Mikre. It's an acronym, Rak Me'ashem, only from the Almighty. The concept of coincidence doesn't exist in a Jewish religion. Does not exist in a Jewish religion. So if HaKadosh Baruch Hu allowed us to do something, because he wants us to do it. And from the other way, because we're naughty. If we have challenges, we have to understand why we have challenges. To open our eyes. We couldn't kill Muhammad death for 10 months. When did HaKadosh Baruch Hu allow us to kill him? 3 weeks ago. In Tammuz. Why dafka then? To kill Yahya Sinwar. Dafka in Av. Okay. What is the Hiddush here? And please God, will be more good news.
Amen.
That HaKadosh Baruch Hu going to allow us to continue with those good news. Be'ezrat Hashem. And we'll see Mashiach, please God.
Amen, amen.
I hope that I answer your question, Jeffrey.
Perfect, perfect, perfect. Thank you.
Pleasure, pleasure. Rabota, any other question? Any other question? Anyone want to ask other question?
Orna, Erev Tov, everybody. Erev Tov, Erev Tov. Hi, Jeffrey.
It's so nice to hear you, Orna. It's so nice to hear you.
It's always good to hear Jeffrey. Then I know that I'm thinking in the right direction. And the Rebbe always puts me, you know, on the derech, on the right road. I just wanted to mention that today, Dafka, on one of my groups, I got a thing from the Netivot Shalom, who wrote about Ben HaMetzarim, the 3 weeks. And he was saying there that the 3 weeks are equivalent to the 22 days between Rosh Hashanah and Simchat Torah. And he says that between Rosh Hashanah and Simchat Torah, those are days that they are like the Yamim Tovim Shel Israel, you know, where we really get so close to Hashem Yitbarach, right? We feel His love, His forgiveness, etc. But he said there that those days are equivalent to the days of the 3 weeks. And he says that Tish'a B'Av is exactly like Simchat Torah. And I thought it was the most unbelievable thought, because last year, 2023, Hashem turned Simchat Torah into Tisha B'Av. For us, and in the same way, next week, 2024, Bezrat Hashem, he can turn our Tisha B'Av into a Simchat Torah.
Amen. Ken, Yehi Ratzon, Bezrat Hashem.
Into a huge Yom Tov, and I thought it was an amazing thought, because it's just like the way Hashem operates, like you said, Rabbi, in the Shiur. You know, it just, you don't, the miracles stare you in the face. You just have to be willing to see them.
To try to understand. Not only that, Ona spoke about 21 days, nachon? These 21 days on, let me tell you a Hiddush. 21 days of the 3 weeks, nachon? From Yudzayin Betamuz until Tisha B'Av, 21 days, nachon?
Mm-hmm.
How many nights there is? 21. Nachon? Together?
Yeah.
Together, how much? 42.
42.
Nachon? Yes, Shem Kadosh. There is a holy name.
Membet. Membet Masaot as well.
Membet. Membet. Maze Membet. Maze Membet. 42. Gematria of Mem is 40. Bet 2. There is a holy name of HaKadosh Baruch Hu that is Koah, strength. So Be'ezrat Hashem, HaKadosh Baruch Hu will reveal and will show his strength on the enemy of the Jews. And that's what he started from Yudzayin Betamuz. Let's see what he's still preparing for us for the final clap that he's going to give them. Yeah. You understand? For the final clap.
Amen.
What did we say every morning in the davening? Va'alu Moshe'im behar Tzion lishpot et har'esav.
Har'esav.
Va'ita la'adonai amlucha va'ya Adonai lemelech al kol ha'aretz. Ba'yom ha'u yiyah Adonai echad u'shmo echad.
U'shmo.
And his name. No other. No other one. The bulldog that hanging there, that's still drying. You know who I'm talking about.
Yeah.
That tried to get dry. And not the other one that was the epilepsy. That they go and throw a stone. La hevel varik. Gematria hevel va'etz. You understand? Echa kol obed.
I do understand, but I don't think that it's revenge. We don't have
a
vengeful God. Listen, because Hashem is doing it lema'an shemo. And our name, Hashem shelanu, nikra al shmo.
The prophet said, the prophet said in Amos, Mize ba hamutz mi botzra. Who's coming? Maze hamutz mi botzra? Sour after he crushed the grapes. Mize ba hamutz mi botzra? Said the Zohar HaKadosh. Listen or not listen. HaKadosh Baruch Hu. A garment, have a garment, a white garment, okay? A nightgown, not like a nightgown, a white gown. That every Jew that been killed because he's Jewish, a drop of blood is on that gown with the face of him. When HaKadosh Baruch Hu gonna come, he gonna do revenge. And when HaKadosh Baruch Hu do revenge, said the Zohar, you know what revenge is doing. Nekom nikmat avadecha shafuch.
Dam avadecha shafuch, yeah.
למה כתוב נקום? למה נקום? Revenge. אז הקדוש ברוך הוא knew that they killed us because we Jew like Dr. Les Elia. Look at the double standard in the world. Look. הקדוש ברוך הוא waiting and waiting and patient. But when he take the revenge, what did we say?
The revenge is leman shemo. Leman shemo is the revenge.
For sure. Why did we been killed? Because we Jew.
Leman
why,
shemo.
Why they hate
right.
us?
The ahava. That's why we've been killed.
Because we are the children of Hashem. Because we Jews. Evant. Oh. As yesh nekama. There is a revenge and will be a revenge. It's not a revenge that we go and kill them. When HaKadosh Baruch Hu decide to get revenge, we don't know how it's going to be. But I want to see how it's going to be because I want to enjoy it.
Yes, I think we all waiting to see it.
That's all what we want. So Be'ezrat Hashem,
thank
we'll
you,
see
Rabbi,
how it goes.
You're amazing, Shurim.
Orna, I'm still waiting for you with the water. Just
Ken,
to remind you.
I know.
I need that.
I have not forgotten. Ani, Chalila, lo shakhti. Ani pashut, we can talk privately.
Ken, nedaber privately. Okay, Rabotai, I hope that you all enjoyed the show. I would like to wish you all Shabbat Shalom, a beautiful evening, a beautiful weekend ahead to all of us. Those of you that can join us on Shabbos for the live show at Yeshiva College an hour before Mincha, I'm going to put the message Be'ezrat Hashem tomorrow. If not, Be'ezrat Hashem, this coming Sunday at 8 o'clock, we're going to learn the Nach about the prophet Samuel. We're going to do another chapter from the prophet Samuel that to learn what was the prophet Samuel, how HaKadosh Baruch Hu in the end showed the miracle, Be'ezrat Hashem, all on Sunday. In the meantime, have a beautiful evening. Thank you for joining us. And again, a beautiful Shabbat Shalom to all of you, full of peace, to Kol Amo Bet Israel, Bechol Makom Shehem, especially in Eretz Israel. Have a good night, everyone. Thank you.
Good Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom.